Good morning, Hillcrest family, and welcome to worship. If you're joining us online, thank you so much for being here today. We're glad you're here. This is the day the Lord's made. We're going to rejoice and be glad at it. This past week was a fantastic week here at Hillcrest because we had vacation Bible school, and believe me, it was not a vacation. And some of our kids, who you guys can go ahead and come on up and get ready to sing, are going to share with you, with our congregation, a song that they sang all this week long. It's called Our God is Holy, and they wanted to share it with you today. So I want to say thank you to all those who worked in Vacation Bible School under the direction and leadership of Miss Diane. They did a fantastic job. Can we just say thank you to all them for all their hard work this week? All right, here is Our God is Holy. So much for that fantastic reminder that we're here to worship a God who is holy, and holy means set apart and other. He's not like us. Thank God. All right, welcome to worship. Would you please stand? Here we go. 1, 2, 3, 4. Come on, help me out now.
Open the prison doors, and he pardoned.
Isn't it great to be worshiping in this room? I just got to pause for a second and say thank you so much to our media ministry team, Thomas Heritage and David Waldo, and all those who helped them get us back into a place where we could be in this room. Would you mind just saying thank you to them, please?
Make your life, but I
while we were yet sinners, he sent his son to die for us. He is a good, good father. Would you please be seated and join me in prayer? Father, we thank you for your goodness. We thank you for your love and mercy that's unending. We are your people, and we come to this moment of our week to start anew, to realign ourselves with the desires of your Spirit as he gives us instruction and direction for righteousness. Father, help us as we open the word that our lives will be transformed by the renewing of our mind. Lord, speak to us in the life group hour time, Lord, as we again open your word to understand more and to more perfectly follow Jesus. Thank you, Father, for our community of faith, and Lord, for those who are in the room and watching online who do not yet know you, who have not made that critical decision to become a follower of Jesus, a disciple of Christ. Lord, speak to them especially today. Through everything that's done in our service, let Jesus be glorified, because it's in his name we pray. Amen.
3, 4.
Jesus the Nazarene.
worship you, Father, with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength. We love you, Lord. Speak to us through the preaching of the word, and let our hearts be soft toward you. In Jesus' holy name, amen. God bless you. Please be seated.
Amen. Give you a few announcements before we get into the study of the word today. One of the things that we've mentioned the last couple of weeks, I want to remind you about again, is that next weekend, a very important weekend in our church, we're going to introduce Karen Raleigh as our candidate for Minister of Education and Administration. There's more information in your bulletin or on the online bulletin about her. We're going to have a leadership breakfast on Saturday for those who are leaders in the church and their spouses. That's going to be on Saturday from 9 to 11. And then we're going to have an ice cream social and a special call business meeting on Sunday night, 6 to 8 p.m. So please make a note of that and plan on coming. And because we've scheduled that event next weekend, we're moving our outdoor baptism from the 9th to the 16th. So on the 16th, we're going to have that. And that is a just kind of a come-and-go type thing. We'll assemble at Twin Lakes YMCA about 1:30, and we'll celebrate the baptism, and then you can hang around if you want. But in previous outdoor baptisms we've had over the years, sometimes we've had an all-afternoon thing where we've eaten lunch there, and we've done activities and all that kind of thing. But this is just going to be simply assembling and celebrating, maybe spending some time with each other, and then heading out when you need to head out. And if this is something that you need to do or you need to talk with your child about, you've got a plenty of time to start thinking about that. It's going to happen on July the 16th. And then volunteers will be needed for, I think this is our seventh, maybe it's just our sixth year of having Mission Anderson. And so you can find more information about that in the bulletin and online as well. And this is just a great way of blessing the students at Anderson High School that are part of the marching band and an opportunity to bless their families as well. Let's go to the Lord in prayer and ask Him to bless this time as we look into His Word. We pray, Lord God, that You will be with us as we are engaged in all these different activities of the church. Be with us now, though, as we open up Your Word and see what it has to say to us about Jesus. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, last Sunday, we began a study through the short letter to the Colossians. What's it all about? Last week, I said it's about taking us to the next level in our Christianity. Maybe you've heard a sports commentator say about an athlete who exceeded expectations. The commentator said he took his game to a whole nother level. Well, when you look in the book of Colossians, Paul is going to take us to a whole nother level and our understanding of how glorious Christ is. And He's going to take us to a whole nother level in our understanding of our mystical union with that glorious Christ. And Paul is going to take us to a whole nother level in the way we ought to live because we are united to that glorious Christ. Jesus is glorious. We are mystically united to that glorious Christ, and therefore we ought to live differently. That is a one-sentence summary of what we're going to look at across the next several months. Now, if that's a good outline for the book of Colossians, then the passage we're going to look at today is going to begin getting into that first point, Christ is glorious. And so in verses 15 through 20, we see how glorious Christ is. Paul writes, "The Son is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For in Him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities, all things have been created through Him and for Him. He is before all things, and in Him all things hold together. And He is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning and the firstborn from among the dead, so that in everything He might have the supremacy. For God was pleased to have all His fullness dwell in Him, and through Him to reconcile to Himself all things, whether things on earth or things in heaven, by making peace through His blood shed on the cross." God bless the reading of His word. You know, whenever I meet with a couple who want to get married, one of the questions I ask sort of as an icebreaker, but it's still an important question, is what attracted you two to each other? Why do you want to get married? And I remember asking that standard question to a couple one time, and the bride-to-be looked over at her husband-to-be and said, "He gets me." Now, what she meant by that was, not everybody understood her quirky moods, but he did. Not everybody understood her, but he did. A lot of people wouldn't appreciate her unique dreams, but he would. He got her. It's important for us to get Jesus. It's important to get another person you're in a relationship with, and that's true when it comes to Jesus as well. I don't know if you saw or remembered seeing in the Super Bowl this year, there was an ad in the mix of these ads for soft drinks and fast cars and that kind of thing. There was an ad for Jesus. Do you remember seeing it? It was from an organization called He Gets Us. And the organization was a collection of pretty well-to-do people, most of them evangelical, who wanted to introduce or reintroduce Jesus to the Western world. So they started this He Gets Us campaign. And it was a good set of ads, encouraging people to realize that Jesus understands us. He gets us in our situation. But as important as that is, the relationship isn't complete until we get the Jesus who gets us. And so what do you need to know about Jesus in order to get him right? Now, this is an important question because there are a lot of people who don't get Jesus. They talk about him, but clearly after talking about him, you've got to conclude that they don't get him. I'm talking about influential professors. I'm talking about talk show hosts. I'm talking about people who write books. I'm talking about famous musicians who talk about Jesus from time to time. They don't always get Jesus right. According to Colossians chapter 1, verses 15 through 20, there are four things you need to know about Jesus in order to get him right. So write these things down as we come to them on your sermon notes. First of all, Jesus reveals God's nature. Jesus reveals God's nature. Verse 15 says, "He is the image of the invisible God." Now, to say that God is invisible does not simply mean that we cannot see him with our physical eyes. That's obvious. What this verse is trying to tell us is there's no way we will be able to understand him. There's no way we'll be able to gather in any information about him just on our own. He's got to reveal himself to us or we're sunk. And so Jesus is God's spelling himself out in language that we can understand. That's what it means when it says he is the image of the invisible God. It's the same thing that Hebrews chapter 1, verse 3 says. That verse says he is the exact representation of God's being. It's the same thing that Jesus himself said in John chapter 14, verse 9, when he said, "Anyone who has seen me has seen the Father." What that means is then you and I need to look through the four Gospels, the biographies of Jesus. And when we see him speaking on a certain subject, we understand God's mind on that subject. When we see his attitude toward the lost and those who are far from God, we see God's attitude toward those who are lost and far from God. When we see his actions toward those who are beaten down by the rich and powerful of the world, we see God's attitude toward those who are beaten down by the rich and powerful of the world. You read the Gospels, and whatever you can discover about the personality of Jesus, that's what God is like. Verse 15 says he is the image of the invisible God. He is the one who makes the invisible God visible to us. Here's the second thing we can say about Jesus according to these passages. Jesus sustains God's creation. So in order for us to get Jesus right, we need to understand that he reveals God to us and he sustains the creation all around us. Now in our day and culture, few people regard Jesus as anything more than a great moral teacher, a way shower, somebody who kind of gives us the direction we need to go ethically, like the Buddha or Muhammad or any other great moral teacher. And yet this passage of Scripture says that he was so much more. Take a look at verses 16 and 17. "For by him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities, all things were created by him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. So Paul lists off the divisions of creation here, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities, you name it, this passage says, Jesus created it and stands above it. So that carpenter of Nazareth who died on a cross outside the walls of Jerusalem was in fact the wellspring from which all creation flows and the ocean toward which all creation goes. This is what we find in these verses. By him, through him, for him, all things were created. What does that mean? First of all, by him. All things were created by him. He stands as the fountainhead out of which everything springs. Everything that you can see, and also the invisible personalities and authorities and forces that you cannot see with your physical eyes. All things were created by him. As John chapter 1 verse 3 says, through him all things were made. Second, it says, through him. All things hold together through him. Hebrews chapter 1 verse 3 says the same thing. The Son sustains everything by his powerful word. So Jesus is no absentee landlord who set this world in motion and then just walked away to let it run on its own. He is a part of every moment in every area of the earth where people dwell. He sustains this creation. And then all things have their destiny in him. Creation exists to fulfill his aims and serve his purpose. And so by him and through him and for him. In other words, Jesus gives the universe its origin and its coherence and its destiny. Now, after reading Colossians chapter 1, reading statements like that, when you get into the Gospels and you read the stories of Jesus doing marvelous and miraculous things, you'll say, of course. Of course, when Jesus stood in front of the wind and waves, in front of the boat, and said, peace be still, the wind and the waves obeyed him. Of course, when Jesus touched diseased bodies, those bodies got healthy again. Of course, when Jesus said, come out of him, to demons, the demons ran away yelping like whipped dogs. Of course, when Jesus stood in front of the tomb of his good friend Lazarus and spoke into the tomb, Lazarus come forth, Lazarus came forth. Because that carpenter turned teacher with blistered feet and bearded face was the one by whom and through whom and for whom all creation came into existence. You know, I remember talking with a man in the last church I served, and he was a non-believer, had very little experience in any sort of church, never read the Bible before, and somebody very helpfully gave him just a simple copy of the Gospel of John. And he was talking with me about it one time. He and I are friends now. We hardly knew each other at that time, but he raised this issue with me because he knew I was a pastor, and he said, you know, you guys expect a lot of us in the world if the first thing you want us to believe is that a man turned water into wine. He was talking about the first miracle you find in the Gospel of John. And I said, but that's not the first thing you're being asked to believe in the Gospel of John. And I took that copy of the Gospel of John from him, turned to chapter 1. And I said, the very first thing you're asked to believe is, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and the Word became flesh and lived in our midst. You believe that, and everything else after that in the Gospel of John is a piece of cake to believe. Now, this is what we find here in Colossians chapter 1. Colossians chapter 1 tells us that this carpenter-turned teacher, this earthly man named Jesus, Colossians chapter 1 pulls back the curtain and lets us see who he really was and who he really is. Now, such a conviction can change the way you view your life. Some of us, we artificially segment our life off into sacred portions and secular portions. And so this is a sacred portion of our lives. We show up at a church most every Sunday, and we listen to songs of faith, and we sing the songs of faith. It's our sacred portion. But then, for some of us, we sort of mentally close everything up, and we go out into the secular portion of our life, and we don't see there's any relation between these things that we're teaching about, and these things that we're singing about on Sunday, and what happens in the rest of the week. But if Colossians chapter 1 is true, and it is, then there is not one square inch in the universe over which Jesus does not say, mine. And that includes what you do on a Friday night date, business decisions, what you do with the way you spend your money, what you do in the voting booth, all of it has implications that come out of our understanding of Jesus in Colossians chapter 1. So we're learning four things that we need to know if we're going to get Jesus right. You've already written down that he reveals God's nature and he sustains God's creation. Here's a third thing. Jesus leads God's people. We see this in verse 18. And he is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning and the firstborn from among the dead, so that in everything he might have the supremacy. So we've already looked at verses 16 and 17, and after that comes verse 18. I did okay in math in high school and college, right? 16 and 17, then verse 18. 16 and 17 tells us that he is the head of creation. Now in verse 18, we see that he is the head of a new creation. What is the new creation that he is referring to here, that the Apostle Paul is referring to? In one of our songs, we sing, the church's one foundation is Jesus Christ, her Lord. She is his new creation by water and the word. The church, the body of Christ, is the new creation. Now, we don't always think of church that way, but in this passage, we think of creation and then the new creation. When you think of creation, what do you think of? You think of waterfalls, you think of mountain ranges, you think of ocean depths, you think of stars in the sky. And then what do you think of when you think of church? Maybe you think of boring old business meetings or something like that. But we need to understand the balance that Paul is trying to help us understand here. If we are caught up in wonder and amazement at what God was capable of doing in creation, what do you think God's capable of doing in the new creation, his church, the body of Christ? So in this passage, he's not referring to a building, although thank God for buildings that the church can meet in. And he's not referring to bylaws and, you know, organizational charts, also, although thank God for that, because that keeps us on track as a church. But what he's talking about here is that Jesus is the head of a new creation. He's talking about you and me. He's talking about how we relate to each other, how we spend time with each other, how we accomplish tasks with each other, how we trust each other, and in trusting each other, we trust God to do the things that we need to do. That's what we're seeing here. He is the head of the body, the church. So that means that you and I collectively together are his hands, his feet, his voice, as we represent him to the world around us. Now, just as the physical creation had a beginning, so this new creation had a beginning. Paul said he is the beginning and the firstborn from among the dead. Now, what does that mean? That means that he was raised to resurrection life after he died on the cross for us. But it wasn't just this one-off thing. Jesus was raised in resurrection life as the firstborn, which means there are more to be born in that way. Who would he be speaking about? You and me. At the end of time, we will also be born into resurrection life, resurrection glory. Jesus was the firstborn of that creation, and there's more to follow. And so as we are mystically united to him, we're going to learn more about that as we move through Colossians, we see that we're already beginning to experience some of that resurrection life. But ultimately, you and I are going to experience everything that Jesus did, not only in dying, but in his rising to new life. We will too. And so that's what the Bible is referring to when it refers to the people of God, the body of Christ. Now, this has implications for individual believers, and it has implications for local churches. First of all, let me say something about those, each one of us as individual believers. I've been reading more and more blog posts, more and more articles from people who have rejected Christianity because of a bad experience in a church of their childhood. And it's almost as if people are saying in those articles that gathering with a church, being involved in a church, doesn't enhance my spirituality, it interferes with it, it interrupts it. And so in order to have true spirituality, I need to leave behind the church. Now the reality is that there are churches who are not good representatives of Jesus Christ. There are churches who don't do that job well. That's true. But if this passage is true, and it is, the church is the body of Christ. You can't say you love Jesus unless you love the things that Jesus loves. And Jesus is crazy about the church. And so we need to be a part of that. We need to be involved in that. But another thing that we we learn in this passage is not just for those of us who are individual believers, but when we collect together, when we join a church, when we're part of a local church, these verses tell us something as well. You know, over the years, and it doesn't matter whether it's a large church, a small church, a mid-sized church, whatever it is, a church, just like individuals, can sometimes fall into a sort of inferiority complex. You know, we start wondering if we can be as effective as we used to be as a church. We start wondering if the world really is at all interested in anything that we've got to offer them. But if we remember who our head is, that he is the Lord of lords and King of kings, that he is the one by whom and through whom and for whom all things hold together, he is the one who died for our sins and rose victoriously again and shares his resurrection power with us. When we remember that, vision grows and fear goes. And so we need to hold to that reality and cling to that reality. So to get Jesus right, I have to recognize that there's work that only he can do. He reveals God's nature. He sustains God's creation. He leads God's people. And write a fourth thing down. Jesus saves God's beloved. So we're just marching through the verses in order here. Verse 15, he reveals God's nature. Verses 16 and 17, he sustains God's creation. Verse 18, he leads God's people. And now in verses 19 and 20, we find out something else. So if verse 18 is about the body of Christ, the church, verses 19 and 20 tell us what Jesus did to get you into that body. And these are some remarkable verses. Take a look at these verses again. And I want you to circle the phrase, God was pleased. And there are two things that God was pleased to do. To have all his fullness dwell in him and through him to reconcile to himself all things. Now, what exactly was God pleased to do? Two things. Look at the phrase, to have all his fullness dwell in him, and God was pleased to reconcile to himself all things. So first of all, God was pleased to have all his fullness dwell in Christ. We've already looked at that in the first point of this sermon. In the Gospels, we see this man named Jesus walking the dusty roads of the Holy Land with blisters on his feet and sweat on his brow. We read that as any other man, he got tired and hungry and thirsty. He wept at the graveside of his good friend Lazarus. But verse 19 pulls back the curtain to reveal that that common teacher of Galilee was everything it means to be God. God was pleased to have all his fullness dwell in him. When God sent his son, he sent his very being into the world of flesh. Our text says that all the fullness of God dwelt in Jesus Christ. Everything that God is, Jesus is. Whatever you could say about God, you could say about Jesus. As the New English Bible translates it, the complete being of God by God's own choice came to dwell. So 2,000 years ago, all the fullness of divine splendor came to live in one man, in Jesus. We have the complete being of God in him. But now look again at verses 19 and 20. Because this passage says that God was pleased to do two things, to have all his fullness dwell in Christ, and then to reconcile all things through Christ. So two things. It was the good pleasure of God to have all his fullness dwell in Christ, and it was the good pleasure of God to reconcile all things through Christ. So notice the sharp contrast, the pendulum swing that's going on here. At one moment, our text has us lost in the wonder of the incarnation of God becoming flesh. At the next moment, our text fixes our gaze on the cross. At one moment, we hear that Christ is God, and then we hear that Christ is a crucified man. In one set of verses in Colossians chapter 1, Paul is telling us that all the fullness of God came to dwell in Jesus, and then Paul gathers up all those glorious statements about Christ and he nails them to the wood of the cross. Nothing could be more emphatic here. His blood shed on the cross. Verses 15 through 20 leave no doubt that Jesus shares in what it means to be God. But then verse 20 reminds us that Jesus shares in what it means to be human. His blood was shed on the cross. Your agony, your suffering, your blood shed, if you were going through this experience, that's all that Jesus experienced as well as he went through what he did on the cross. No wonder Simon Peter writes what he does in 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 18. For you know that it was not with perishable things, such as silver or gold, that you were redeemed. Indeed not. It was by the very blood of this Christ who perfectly represented God to us. That is what redeems us. God was pleased to have all his fullness dwell in Christ. God was pleased to redeem us to himself through the work of Christ. I heard somebody say one time, clearly they did not understand. They did not understand the atonement. They did not understand what was going on the cross. And this person referred to our understanding of atonement, referred to our understanding of Jesus giving himself up for our sins. He referred to it as cosmic child abuse. That the Heavenly Father punishing the Son so that we might be set free. Do you know why that guy misunderstood? That guy misunderstood Colossians chapter 1. Because in Colossians chapter 1, it doesn't tell us that Jesus was some whipping boy for us. It doesn't even tell us that Jesus kind of intervened between this brutally angry God and you and me. This passage tells us that the judge bore our judgment. That the one who was disappointed with our sin bore the consequences for our sin. And that's what's so astonishing about understanding what God was pleased to do here. God was pleased that all his fullness would dwell in Jesus Christ, and God was pleased to reconcile the world to himself in that manner, in that way. It's as if a judge banged the gavel down and declared you guilty and then took his robes off and stepped down from the judge's bench and stood before you or beside you and said, but you may go. I'm going to bear the punishment myself. This is the God we worship. This is the God who saved us, and this is the manner in which God saves us. So, do you get Jesus? Do you understand him? According to today's passage, you can't say you do until you recognize these four things. He reveals God's nature, he sustains God's creation, he leads God's people, and he saves God's beloved. Let's ask God to help us understand these things so we can get Jesus right. Let's pray. Father, thank you for this passage. If we get Jesus right, we'll get everything else right. If we understand what's true about him, everything else lines up, and we'll understand what's true about our lives, our church, our relationships. Help us and help those we love to get Jesus right. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. There is a connection card in the pew rack in front of you. Those of you who are watching online, you'll see a QR code pop up on the screen. And what I'd like you to do right now is point your phone toward that QR code or take that connection card out. And would you make a note letting us know that you are in attendance with us today here or watching online? And if you have a decision you want to talk with me about to join up with this church or join up with Jesus, there's a spot on that card for you to let us know about that too. Let's have our musicians come up now and lead us in this last song. And for those of you who are new here, we have a worship service at 10, and then we have a 15-minute coffee fellowship. We meet in the gym for that, and so follow the signs or follow the crowd to the gym. And that's where I'll be, so if you're visiting today, come and introduce yourself to me and maybe get a fresh ground cup of coffee. And then if you can stay after that coffee fellowship, we have our life group hour that meets at that point. And you'll get to know the Bible better and get to know some people better by being part of one of our life groups. Let's have Paul Waldo, our Deacon of the Week, lead us in this prayer now.
Pray with me. Heavenly Father, we, as we gather here this morning, have so much to be thankful for. We are thankful for our church. We are thankful for our pastor and for the message he's given us this morning about our glorious Jesus that we came here today to worship. Jesus as our creator, our sustainer, our redeemer. Lord, we know that you, everything that we have, everything that we are, every beat of our hearts, every breath that we breathe, all of our material possessions come from you. You have given us gifts beyond measure. And now we come to a place in our service where we return a small portion of what you've given to us. We do this gladly, and we do it freely out of love for Jesus. We ask that you bless these tithes and offerings and use them, help us to use them and wisely in ways that serve you and bring glory to the name of Jesus. It's in his name that we pray. Amen.
Like this.
I will.
Lord, with all